Lorenzo, for the introduction, and I also want to thank the organizers for the invitation, and I hope to see you soon in a non-virtual meeting. Well, in my talk, I will present a vorticity stabilized virtual elements for the Ossian equation. This is a joint work with Lorenzo Berouda Vega and Franco Dassi from the University of Milano Bicocca. Well, the outline of the presentation in the first part, I will record the basic concepts of the so-called divergence-free virtual elements for the Stokes and Navier-Stokes equation. So in particular, the definition, the degrees of freedom, the construction of the projections, and its main properties. So the divergence-free property of the solution, the kernel inclusion, and its advantages. In the second part, I will present the vorticity stabilization for the Ossian equation. In particular, we will see how to stabilize the vorticity equation related to the Ossian equation and to put this formulation in the VM setting. In conclusion, I will draw some remarks. Well, of course, this topic, the topic of polygonal methods for fluid mechanics problem, is have been widely studied. I have just mentioned a very short and not exhaustive list of technologies and related topic in related papers in this field. Okay, the idea is the construction and definition of our discrete space. For the velocities is to exploit the flexibility of the virtual element construction. So, in order to design a virtual element space such that it yields a discrete solution that is exactly divergence-free. So now I will show you the construction of the method of the space. So we start with a polygonal decomposition of the domain. That I denote with omega h, e denotes a general element of the tessellation, k, greater or equal than 2, denotes the polynomial order of the method. The lowest order version of the method has been introduced in this paper. Well, the idea, so of course, a virtual element fashion, is to define the virtual element space as the set of functions that solve a PDE within the element. In this case, so the function solve a Stokes problem within the element. So just to see the definition, in particular, our virtual element functions are polynomials and continuous on each edge. The item two, the most important, the divergence of our functions is a polynomial of degree k minus one. And the first item is just to say that the right-hand side of the first equation of the item I is a polynomial of this kind, where X perp is the rotated orthogonal to the vector of the coordinate. It's just to set the right dimension of the space. But in some sense, the most important idea and item of the definition is the second one. So some properties, okay, in general, standard virtual element setting, our functions are virtual, so they are defined implicitly as the solution of a PDE. Again, I stress that the divergence is a polynomial of degree k minus one on each polygon. The polynomials are included in this space. The item two and three are straightforward, but also the item one is easy to check. The dimension of the space is given by the dimension of the data that define the Stokes problem. So the dimension of the boundary data is 2k times the number of edges. The dimension of this data, of the first equation data, so the dimension of the polynomials of degree k minus 3, and then the dimension of the divergence term, so the polynomial of degree k minus 1 minus 1, this one minus 1 because we have the compatibility condition given by the divergence theorem. Okay, what about the degrees of freedom? So we are dealing with a conforming method. So on the boundary, we have the expected degrees of freedom. So the values of the functions at the vertices and at k minus one internal distinct point on each edge. So in particular, here we have k equal to two and k equal to three. So we have 3 points on each edge for k equal to three and 4 points on each edge for k equal to three. Okay. So what about this part of the dimension? This part of the dimension is taken into account by these moments. So the moments of D against the polynomials of this type. So we have no degrees of freedom for k equal to 2 and just one degrees of freedom of this type for k equal to 3. Finally, this part of the dimension, so the gold one, is taken into account by the moment of the divergence against the polynomials of degree k minus 1 and greater than 0. So we have just 2 degrees of freedom for k equal to 2 and 5 degrees of freedom for k equal to 3. Okay, what about the computability of the projection? Okay, we have, of course, our functions are not defined, are not known in explicit form, they are defined implicitly, so we need to introduce, in standard Venn setting, some polynomial projections. What we can do with our degrees of freedom, we are able to compute the polynomial projection onto the polynomial of degree k, and also the polynomial projection onto the tensor polynomials of degree k of the gradient of our discrete function. Okay, actually I am using the enhancing, so-called enhancing technique introduced in this paper. I avoid to exploit the construction of the enhanced space for the Stokes equation, but it follows the idea introduced in this paper. So we are able to compute this projection. Okay. Let's come back to the definition of the space. So our velocity space is defined, okay, is obtained by collecting and doing the local spaces. So our velocity space is given by the functions that are in H1 and that solve locally a PDE in Stokes' problem. In particular, we recall that our divergence is a polynomial of degree k minus 1 on each element. What about the Bessel space? The Bessel space, we take the simplest space, so the piecewise polynomial of degrees k minus 1. So as you can see, by construction, we have that the divergence of our virtual functions is included in QH, in the pressure space. So looking at the incompressibility constraint of our discrete problem, since we are looking for a discrete solution that solves this equation, so the divergence of UH against all the pressures is zero, you can see that automatically we have that our discrete solution is pointwise divergence free. And this property is not shared by the most popular finite element method. Okay, more general, we have a more general property. If we define the continuous kernel zeta as the set of functions that are divergence free and our discrete kernel zeta h, we have the observation of the previous slide that the discrete kernel is included in the continuous one. And this yields a series of advantages. So we have a sort of decoupling of the error, that means that the velocity error depends indirectly by the pressure with an higher order term. We can reduce the number of degrees of freedom in the final linear system. This method, this family is stable also for the Darcy flow. And we have an underlying Stokes complex structure that means that our discrete kernel can be characterized as the curve of NH2 conforming virtual element space. Okay, the idea is to apply this machinery, this family, to the Diozian equation. Diozian equation is an equation in this form. In particular, the key ingredients of the Diozian equation are the viscosity, the fluid viscosity nu, the advective field beta that we assume is the divergence free, and the reaction coefficient sigma. So it's a mixed problem, and those are the ingredients, the main ingredients for the stability of the Diozian equation. This equation can arise, for instance, when we discretize the time-dependent Navier-Stokes equation, when, for instance, we apply a time integrator method such as the implicit theorem, we recover this equation. So now, the problem is that it is well known that when in the convection-dominated regime, so when nu is much smaller than beta, the discretization of this problem leads to instabilities. So we have to stabilize this problem. Okay. The second problem is that, okay, if we use a standard technique such as SUPG stabilization for the Diozian equation, we may use the good properties of the divergence free spaces because we have a sort of artificial combination of the pressure and the velocity. So we, in some sense, this in some sense spoils the good property of the space. So we have to choose careful the stabilization, the strategy for the Ossian equation. So in this sense, we follow the stabilization, the approach proposed in this paper by Hamed, Balanacea, Ullmann, Guzman, Lincoln, and Merdon, is a very recent paper. So, and they consider the vorticity equation. So assume that the curve is in L2, so they consider the vorticity equation. So this is the first line, in some sense, of the Ossian equation where you take the curve. As you can see, clearly, here the gradient of the pressure disappear. Why disappear? Because the curve of a gradient is zero. So we automatically, in this equation, can eliminate the presence of the gradient of the pressure. That is, in some sense, that spoils the divergence-free property of the solution. Okay, so the idea now is to apply a sort of SUPG-like stabilization to that equation. So to this vorticity equation, so we define this stabilized form, cal L, and the associated right-hand side, cal F, that is a sort of SUPG stabilization of the vorticity equation. Here, tau E is the stabilization parameter. Okay, so introducing this stabilizing form, what we have is that our the solution of the Ossian equation, the continuous solution, solves also this problem. Well, okay, we take the variational formulation of the Ossian equation, and as you can see, we add the term form L at the left-hand side and the form F at the right-hand side. Of course, this problem can be also posed in the kernel formulation, so we are looking for a solution U that is divergence-free, so we can eliminate this row, and this is the formulation in the kernel setting. So as you can see, the form L does not depend on B. Okay, so we want to use our virtual element spaces VH and QH in order, then the divergence free couple, in order to discretize the Ossian equation. So we want to construct our virtual element method in this form. Well, so we need to introduce a discrete form AH approximating the epsilon epsilon form, a discrete form CH approximating the convective term, and a discrete form MH that approximates the L2 form, and also the approximation LH that approximates the SUPG form in some sense. For the term F, we do not need to introduce any approximation. Okay, of course, since our discrete kernel is included in the continuous one, we also can pose the problem directly in the kernel setting. Okay, so what about the approximated forms? So the epsilon-epsilon form and the L2 form are straightforward. So in them setting, we just put the projection where they are needed and we use the classical stabilization of them technologies, such as Dofi-Dofi and other recipe. The same for the L2 form, we just put the projection. Maybe for the convective term, the convective term deserves more explanation. So we have to discretize this guy. So look at that beta is divergence free. So this form at continuous level is Q-symmetric. We want to preserve this property at discrete level. So as you can see, we discretize this term in its skew symmetric form. In this way, as you can see, if UH is equal to VH, this term is clearly zero, this is, so it is skew symmetric. Another observation is that for people addicted with them, one can expect here the projection onto the polynomials of degree k-1. We here take the full projection of the gradient onto the space of polynomial k. This is a useful for the proof. Okay, so we take the full projection of the grid. Other possible choices for the convective term have been studied. I will come back later on this aspect. Okay, now the stabilization, the form LH that approximates the SUPG form CalL. Okay, so we need to approximate this guy. So the form CalLH can be seen as the sum of these three terms. The first one, the term less, is the discretization of the band discretization in some sense of the form L. So we just put the projection where it's needed. So we put the projection in the right, the expected place. The second stabilization, the second part of the stabilization, this jump penalizes the jump of the gradients along the direction beta. And the last term of the stabilization is a sort of BEM stabilization of the stabilization. So here, beta E is the L infinity norm of beta, and this guy is needed to stabilize the curl term in L less and also the jump term here. Okay, so the stabilizations, this part of the stabilization stabilize both of these two guys. Okay. So we have the norm associated with the discrete form. We have these two terms coming from the original terms of the Ossian equation, but plus these three terms coming from the stabilization. This is related with the residual. This coming from comes from the jump, and this from the stabilization. Okay, we have the, of course, the stability of the method. So we have this coercivity result. So I just want to stress this convergence result. So assuming a maximum regularity for the data and the solution, I focus on the, in the most interesting case, on the convection dominating regime. So when nu is much smaller than beta, so the stability parameter is chosen in accordance with this equation. So and as you can see, we recover the optimal order of convergence, that is beta e times h to the power of 2k plus 1. We are considering the square, of course. We have here this degenerative term, but it is weighted with the h to the power 3, so it's not so bad. And we can also improve this estimate, this degenerative term, using an alternative discretization of the convective term. Moreover, okay, we have this dependence on the road, but as you can see, this is a higher order dependence on the road. So we preserve the capping of the error that I mentioned few slides before. So the error on the velocity does not depend directly on P, it depends through the road F, but as you can see, we have a higher order in such dependence. In the diffusion dominated regime and the reaction dominated regime, of course, we get the optimal order of convergence. Okay, just in this slide, some comments. I repeat what I already said, that so in the diffusion dominated, the reaction dominated case, we get the optimal order. Also in the convection dominated case, we get this optimal order. The generative factor is weighted by h to the power 3, so it's not so bad, and we can also improve this estimate with a different convective form. Another important property is that we can recover this approximation error for the two in the L2 norm. That is not recovered with standard finite element in the convection dominated regime. So for the pressures, we get the same results regarding the error. The method is quasi pressure robust in the sense that the velocity error does not depend directly by the pressure, but we have an higher order dependence through the road. The important, I want just to stress this last line, is in green. A key ingredient in the proof is that our virtual element family enjoys an underlying Stokes structure. So we can characterize the curve, the discrete kernel, as the curve of an H2 conforming space. Okay, I am a little bit late, so I skip, but of course the numerical results confirm the theoretical evidence. And okay, I just this the conclusion, and thank you for your attention.